There's healing for your pain.
Healing for your pain.
Healing for your spirit.
Healing for your spirit.
There's shelter from the rain.
There's shelter from the rain.
Lord, send the healing. That there's healing for your sorrow.
There's healing for your sorrow.
Healing for your pain.
Healing for your pain.
Healing
for your spirit.
There's shelter from.
About biblical healing provisions. Bible or biblical healing provisions. And I say biblical because there are so many ways that people get healed. But we are talking about the Bible way to get healed. You see, when God heals, even the scars, you don't see them there anymore. When God heals, He does it in a very perfect way. It is supernatural. There are no side effects. Can I hear an amen? There are no side effects when Christ heals. Every medication has side effects, even death. If you read the fine print, they'll tell you, you might die from having taken this medication. Biblical healing provisions. In Jesus' earthly ministry, he healed the blind. He healed the sick. He raised the dead. He cleansed the lepers. He did so many amazing things in his earthly ministry. That's why we can believe God for healing, because we know that that is his plan for our lives. We talked about it last week Sunday. Divine health is God's will. So we know it is God's will. So nobody here will be praying the prayer of, Lord, if it is your will, heal my mother or heal my father or heal me. No, that is a prayer of unbelief. Can I hear an amen? So we know that healing is God's will for us. The same way salvation is God's will for everybody. Jesus even sent out 12 disciples to go and heal the sick. In Matthew chapter 10, verse 7 to 8, Jesus said, and as you go, preach, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Heal the sick, cleanse the lepers. That was the instruction that Jesus gave to them. Has that instruction changed? No. Because he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. In Luke chapter 10, 1 to 9, Jesus also sent out 70 disciples, and among the instruction he gave them was, and heal the sick there, and say to them, the kingdom of God has come near to you. In Mark chapter 16, verse 17 to 18, the Bible says, and this sign shall follow those who believe. How many believers do we have this morning? Amen. These signs shall follow those who believe. Which means this is how you would know those that truly believe. You don't need to tell me a person is a woman or a person is a man. I can see. You don't need to tell me this one is a child. I can see. These signs shall follow those who believe. It is very, very obvious. It is not what we say with our mouth. This is the way we know those who believe. In Mark 16, 17, and 18. In my name, they will cast out demons. They will speak with new tongues. They will take up serpents, and if they drink anything deadly, it will by no means hurt them. And they will lay hands on the sick, and they will what? Recover. So you all can go and print out business cards. Professional healing technician. Amen. Hallelujah. I'll lay hands on you. You can even package your hand in bottles and and send it to people. Amen. He says, and you will lay hands on the sick and they will recover. So we have the ministry of laying on of hands for miracles to happen. So we know that God wants us to be healed and to remain in divine health. It's not one day sick, tomorrow well, one day sick. No. Constantly in divine health. We talked about this on Thursday. One of the major reasons why people don't get healed is lack of faith. And many times it's because of a lack of understanding. You never hear someone preach and say, hey, Jesus does not want to save everybody. We always hear people say, you come to him, he will save you, no matter what you have done. So, salvation is for everybody. So, no matter how bad a person is, we believe that they can be saved, because that is God's plan for them. But many times, the messages we hear about healing is, maybe it's God's will, or God is trying to teach you something, or he wants to draw you closer to him. That is not biblical. Hallelujah. So our faith needs to be very strong when we are asking God for healing or when we are administering healing to people. Can I hear an amen? Hallelujah. Now, what are the provisions for healing? Number one, asking the Father in Jesus' name. Asking the Father in the name of Jesus. You will not get healed by laying on your bed and crying and crying and crying. That is not the solution to healing. The only time God answered people when they cried was when they cried to Him. Not just crying. Crying will not do anything. To do some things, you get to, you know, release some liquid, excess liquid in your body, which is fine. Amen. But apart from that, nothing. Asking the Father in the name of Jesus. In John chapter 14, verse 13 to 14, John 14:13-14, the Bible says, "And whatever you ask in my name, that I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it." And anything includes healing. Anything includes healing. Be it emotional healing, physical healing, spiritual healing, everything includes healing. Asking the Father in the name of Jesus. John 16:23, the Bible says, "And in that day you will ask me nothing. Most assuredly I say to you, whatever you ask the Father in my name, he will give it to you." So, what does this mean? The key to applying this provision of the Bible is to believe in the power in the name of Jesus. If you don't believe that the name of Jesus is powerful, you can never be able to properly appropriate the name of Jesus. The Bible says that He has given Him the name that is above every other name. Do you know that every disease has a name? Every disease has a name. They gather some symptoms together and they name it cancer. They name it high blood pressure. They name it arthritis. They name it all sorts of things. And I was reading the other day, there's actually a very long name for a disease that they don't know what the name is. So whenever you are exhibiting certain symptoms and it fits a category, they just give it that generic name. Everything has a name. And the Bible says that Jesus has been given the name that is above every other name. But the name must be used in faith. So whenever we are administering healing to people, we must believe in the power in the name of Jesus. My mentor shared a very funny story. He said he was in the car with his wife, you know, and they were driving. And all of a sudden, he lost control of the car and they were almost about to get an accident. And his wife just started saying, "Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus." And he just stopped and said, no, only once is enough. You don't need to say Jesus many, just once is enough. Because he understands the power in the name of Jesus. There are some medications that you just need to take one tablet, even half. If you take more than one, you might die because it's very powerful. The name of Jesus is very powerful to those who believe. Can I hear an amen? So we are commanding sickness to leave in the name of Jesus. That's what we do when we use the name of Jesus. You sickness, I command you to leave in the name of Jesus. You headache, I command you to leave in the name of Jesus. With confidence, with boldness, with the authority in the name of Jesus. You're not trying to see whether it will work or not. Leave in Jesus' name. Has it gone? No. You know it has to leave. Amen. Hallelujah. I read a testimony that happened in the U.S. Thank you, Father. This woman had a cancerous growth, a tumor in her head, and it was bulging. And she went to a man of God for healing. And according to the leading of the Holy Spirit, he told her to just be declaring every day, I am healed, I am healed, I am healed. In the name of Jesus, I am healed. For 10 days. We need to learn how to follow instructions. Many times we have our own ideas. We are told 10 days, but in our head we hear 7 days. And you do it for 7 days. You say 7 means perfection. And then nothing happens. And you come back and say God did not do anything. Anyway, she continued doing it for 10 days. In the morning, in the afternoon, and at night. On the 10th day, she called the man of God where he was. And she was screaming, ha! The cancerous growth has fallen off her face. And she could see it on the floor with tentacles, with roots. On the floor. Try to imagine it. It's either I'm lying or you can't just believe it. It fell on the floor. You see, sicknesses are, they have a mind of their own. They can leave a person. That's what I want us to understand. In Mark chapter 1, verse 42, let's read that together. Mark 1, 42. Sicknesses can leave. They are many times called the spirit of infirmity. The Bible says, as soon as he had spoken, that is Jesus, the leprosy what? Left him. It left. What does that mean to you? It left. It has a mind of its own. It can leave. It can be commanded to leave, and it will leave. Headaches can leave. Cancer can leave. Pains can leave. They are looking at me. They can leave. He says, and the leprosy left him. And after the leprosy left, he was cleansed because the leprosy was causing him not to be clean. So, in the name of Jesus, we can receive our healing and command sicknesses to leave in the name of Jesus. And your basis is first, is Mark 1:42. Do you know that depression is a spirit? If you don't know, go and read about Saul. When the Spirit of God left him, an oppressing spirit came to oppress him, and he was depressed. But anytime David would play, he would get temporary relief. Because why? The spirit was not cast out. It was just, you know, it could not stay in a place of anointed worship. That's why you might be down or depressed, but when you come to church, you're feeling great in an anointed environment. But when you get back home, it seems like it has come back again. Why? Because it did not leave. It just could not function in that particular environment. Their spirit. In the name of Jesus, you spirit of infirmity, I command you to leave. You spirit, depressing spirit, I rebuke you in the name of Jesus. It will be making you feel weak, making you feel confused, making you feel hopeless for no reason. Because if you really open your eyes and look at your life, you will see that there are many things to be thankful for. That's what the Spirit does. That's what it does. So, there is power in the name of Jesus. In Acts chapter 3 verse 6, in the book of Acts chapter 3 verse 6, Peter was teaching us how to use the name of Jesus. Acts chapter 3, verse 6. It says, then Peter said, silver and gold I do not have, but what I have I do give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ, rise up and walk. Can I hear an amen? This is how we use the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, you rise up and walk. In the name of Jesus, you headache, I command you to leave. Glory to God. The second example is in Acts chapter 16, verse 18. In the life of Paul the apostle, Acts chapter 16, verse 18. The book of Acts, 16, 18. And I read, and this she did for many days. There was a woman, a girl that had a spirit of divination that could tell things that will happen. It's not everybody that can tell you the future that is operating in the Holy Spirit. You need to know that. Oh, he told me what I ate this morning. No, not everybody that tells you the future or the past or the present is operating in the Holy Spirit. But Paul, greatly annoyed because he knew this was not the Holy Spirit, he turned and said to the Spirit, not the girl, the Spirit. He said to the Spirit, not the girl. Many people are carnally minded. They are not spiritually minded. Amen. Paul knew that the problem was not the girl. The problem was the spirit operating inside of the girl. Destroy the spirit, rescue the girl. So he looked at her and he says, I command you in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her. I was going to ask, has anybody ever been arrested before? But don't raise up your hand. Amen. Amen. But in this part of the world, when they want to summon a person, or if you've had a speeding ticket, all those kind of things, they say, we summon you in the name of the Queen. Have you ever noticed that before? Amen. They can't just write you a letter and say, appear. No. Which authority do you have? So they state the authority in the name of Her Majesty, the Queen. Glory. Hallelujah. And when you see that, you say, "Ooh, Her Majesty, the Queen. She's all the way in England, but she has power here." The same way they know spiritually that demons bow at the mention of the name of Jesus. So don't go in your name. I command you in the name of Jesus. Let me see how you're going to stand in the name of Jesus. The only time this does not work is when there is no faith. Because in the spiritual realm, spirits, things are not hidden. They can see whether you believe what you're saying or not. You might act like you're bold, but inside they can see whether you believe what you're saying or not. You don't need to shout it. It is a faith. Understand that no demon can stand when you mention the name of Jesus in faith. Hallelujah. Glory to God. What is the basis of this? Let's read Philippians chapter 2 from verse 9 to 10. Philippians chapter 2 from verse 9 to 10. Amen. Philippians chapter 2 from verse 9 to 10. And I read, therefore, God also has highly exalted him and given him the name which is above every name, even your name and my name, that at the name of Jesus, every what? Every knee should bow. Authority. Both of those in heaven, and of those on the earth, and of those under the earth. So tell me, what is not covered in that category? In heaven, on the earth, and then under the earth. Where else is there apart from those three categories? Amen. So the name of Jesus works at all levels. It works in all categories, works everywhere. If you go underwater, you can use the name of Jesus. If you happen to go to space, to Mars, you can use the name of Jesus. If you find aliens there, amen. I command you in the name of Jesus. Bow. And they will bow. Hallelujah. You know, you might have experienced this before. You have a dream or something. Someone is choking you, which is not supposed to happen, but perhaps it happens. Amen. By the time you even think of the name of Jesus, they leave. Because there are times some people cannot even open their mouth to speak because they feel under pressure. But the moment you begin to think the name of Jesus, and it's as if it's already coming out, they already know, and they leave. Don't think of your name. Think of the name of Jesus. Amen. What you believe in real life will also translate to your spiritual life. In your dreams, while you are awake, anywhere you are, because you are the same person. Hallelujah. This is spiritual warfare 101. Amen. The name of Jesus, that is the main power. And it works with sicknesses. Glory to God. Number two provision is the power of agreement. The power of agreement. Oh, thank you, Jesus. The power of agreement. In Matthew chapter 18, verse 19 to 20, the Bible says, "Again, I say to you that if two of you agree on earth concerning anything they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered together in my name, I will be there in the midst of them." Are we more than two here? Yes. More than three? Yes. Are we gathered in the name of Jesus? I know I am. Amen. Hallelujah. So Christ is in our midst. Glory to God. I've said this many times. Growing up, the only way I used to know that Jesus was there was when people start falling, they start screaming. Ah, I say, "Hey, Jesus is here." I become quiet. But as I grew up, and I'm still growing, I began to realize that it's not only when people start falling that Jesus is there. Because his word says it, and I believe his word. Glory to God. How many people believe that you have blood inside of you? Can you see the blood now outside? Amen. Except if you have a cut. You can't see it. But why do you believe you have blood? You're alive. Okay. Amen. You don't see the blood externally, but you believe you have blood. That's the same thing. His word says so. So I believe it. And if anybody misbehaves, then the presence of God will manifest. And then you see, oh, I did not know, but he was there. The power of agreement. When Jesus sent out his disciples in twos, he was using the power of agreement. When God instituted marriage, he was establishing the power of agreement. That's what he was doing. Because if two or three gather in the name of Jesus, there is tremendous power available. That's why the Bible says we should dwell together in love and unity so that there can always be power in our midst. The moment one person is offended at the other, not, it breaks the chain of power. Hallelujah. So there are certain things that you've tried and tried and tried, it's not working. Then you now get in agreement with somebody that believes, and then you see power made available. This agreement is not just external, it is mainly internal agreement. I can say, okay, you know, how many people believe Jesus is the Son of God? Everybody say, "Yes, I believe." But that does not really mean you believe. It is what you believe in your heart that matters. It is what you and I believe in our hearts that matters. Amen. So, in divine healing, it is whenever a person, one person believes, they can actually get healed. They don't need agreements with anybody else. If they are mentally responsible, if they are mentally able to believe, they don't need to agree with someone before they can get healed. Is that understood? Amen. So they don't really need to agree with anybody else. If you are able to understand the word and believe the word, you can receive your healing on your own. On your own. But the problem occurs when a person either is in a coma, or the person is unable to reason, or because of the pain they cannot focus on the word, then people can now step in and agree with them. Or maybe perhaps the person is still a baby, and then they can be carried and breastfed. But normally, we, each individual, can believe God for their own healing so far as we are born again. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Number three provision is anointing with oil. The anointing oil is the number three provision for divine healing. Anointing oil. And as the Holy Spirit leads, we'll have another anointing service. We'll bless the anointing oils and everything. I've seen too many miracles with the anointing oil. Too many. Too many. We don't worship the oil. We worship God that anoints the oil. And I always say that it is normal oil. You can even use the same oil you used to cook. You can use any kind of oil, not necessarily olive oil. Many people just like to use olive oil because it is healthy to be ingested. That's why. There's nothing about it. Any kind of oil. The main thing is your faith. Your faith is what really matters. The same thing with the communion. We don't need to import the communion from Israel. Amen? No. It is your faith. While they were eating, he took from the bread and from the drink and he blessed it. He didn't order it specially from anywhere. The same thing with the oil. The main thing is it is anointed. It is blessed. And you, by faith, can do that yourself, or somebody higher than you can anoint it, and you receive it in faith, and it begins to work wonders. In James chapter 5, verse 14 to 15, let's read James chapter 5, verse 14 to 15. Everything that we do must be based on the word of God. There are times the Holy Spirit can lead us to do things, but our doctrine has to be based on the word of God. And in two or three witnesses, then we can believe that this is the way God wants it to be done. Amen. Can God ask you to anoint water for healing? Of course. But that is not a doctrine. That is not a doctrine. Amen. The Bible says, is anyone among you sick? Let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him. Anointing him with what? In the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith will save the sick, and God will raise him up. And if he has committed sins, he will be what? Forgiven. So, the anointing with oil in the name of Jesus can heal the sick. Let's look at another scripture. In Mark chapter 6, verse 13. Mark 6, 13. The disciples also used the anointing oil for healing. The Bible says, and they cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and healed them. Now we have seen two examples. And in the mouth of two or three witnesses, the truth is confirmed. So the anointing with oil is a confirmed doctrine. is confirmed, anointed with oil, is confirmed as a doctrine. But the Bible says it is a prayer of faith. So whatever we do must be done in faith. Because the thing itself does not have any power. It is our faith that activates the power in it. In the same way, gas on its own, or kerosene, or propane does not have any power. But by the time you light the matches, I'm not going to be around you then. Amen? Because there will be an explosion. Our faith is what causes the explosion. Amen. We need to believe. We need to believe. We need to believe. The prayer of faith. It is impossible to have faith and have doubt at the same time. It's not possible. I know beyond a doubt that God heals. And He heals me. And He can heal anybody that believes. Glory to God. So whenever that headache comes, don't entertain it. No. Don't entertain it. In the name of Jesus, you headache, go back to where you came from. I cast you out and continue your life. You're doing things and you get the pain. In the name of Jesus, you pain, I command you to leave now. And then he leaves and continue doing your thing. I remember I was in my home. I was dancing and worshiping God. In Job chapter 1, the Bible says, when the children of God gathered, even the devil came. I was worshiping, and all of a sudden I bent down, I was dancing my traditional dance, and my back just froze. You know how you're dancing those dances and you freeze, and then you hand over to the other person? Those that remember, oh, you guys are too old. You know, and I just froze. And immediately, thoughts just started coming to my head. You better call 911. What's going on? Well, I was in pain. But I remembered Colossians chapter 2, verse 15. Immediately, it flowed from inside my heart. Amen. Having disarmed principalities and powers, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in the cross. In the name of Jesus, you back, I command you to be loose. And everything came back to normal. Only God knows what could have happened from there if I did not go the Bible way. Only God knows. You just freeze. Amen. Only God knows. So many things that we've experienced that is a spirit of infirmity trying to join itself with us. But the moment you realize, in the name of Jesus, I command you to leave, and it leaves. And because spirits must occupy a body, they go and look for somebody else to attach themselves with. The same way the tumor attached itself. God did not call it a tumor. It is we human beings that called it one. Oh, yes. Called it one. And he just, they need to attach. And then he goes around looking for an empty body to inhabit. And then he comes, attaches himself to somebody. And they start to feel pain. Oh. And then the same spirit now suggests to them, cancer. It's, cancer. I have cancer. And then he now stays. He says, thank you. Welcome home. And then he now releases itself. And he now makes that place its home. But when you are enlightened with the word of God, you know what is going on. Hallelujah. And you say, no. Satan, I rebuke you in the name of Jesus. Do you know that? I always like to ask this question as we round up in closing. Can you imagine Jesus Christ having cancer? Can you imagine Jesus Christ having pains? His knees are aching, or he has headaches. He will tell Peter, go and get me cold water. My head is hot. I cannot imagine that happening. I can't imagine. Everybody, they are looking for, where is Jesus? Ah, didn't you hear? Ah, he's sick. Jesus didn't come to work today. He's sick. Amen. He called in sick. It cannot happen. And the Bible says, herein is love perfected, for as he is, so are we in this world. So it means that we are representing Christ on the earth. So whatever cannot happen to him is not meant to happen to us. Listen now and be saved. Listen. Whatever cannot happen to Jesus must not happen to you and I. What the devil will try to tell you is you're not holy enough or you are a sinner. But we are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. So righteousness is based on believing by faith that Jesus has done the work for you. The Bible tells us that our body is a temple of the Holy Spirit. So imagine the temple of the Holy Spirit with cancer. The Holy Spirit is there, and then there is also cancer at the same time. It must not happen. It must not happen. Romans 10:17 says, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So, as we're hearing the word, our faith is coming alive that no way, I am not going to be sick. Then you might be asking, okay, this sounds good, but how will I die if I don't fall sick? You don't have to be sick to die. You grow old and just close your eyes, and then your spirit will leave and you're dead. You don't need to be sick. You do not need to be sick. Mentally, spiritually, physically, we are not meant to be sick. Sickness came into the world because of sin. Your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 19 to 20. Because of sin, that's how sickness and diseases came into the world. Hallelujah. I mean, many of us in this day and age, we know about germs and viruses. We know about that. And our knowledge differs depending on your profession or your educational background. We know about that. So I would not expect anybody to go into a germ-infested place and just be swimming in it. Just swimming and drinking the water and say, oh, I just love this. I not expect to be sick. Amen. So I don't expect that because we have understanding. That's in the physical realm. If you drink Coke from today, don't drink water, from today, the whole of the month, I mean, every single day, morning, afternoon, and evening, you must expect your body to act funny. They put a tooth inside of a bottle of Coke and left it there for a few days. It dissolved. No, seriously, it dissolved. So we have our part to play. I understand that. But nobody is perfect. Even the things that we eat and we think they are healthy, like fruits. Do you know that? So I'm not trying to scare you. They tested some fruits in some stores in North America, and some of them had urine on them. Oh yes. So you know, there is a part you play. There are things you do out of ignorance, and there are some things you should know better, and you should not do them. It's just like me going out in winter. I don't wear any jacket. I say I am the son of God, and I'm just going in winter. Winter will winterize me. Amen. I will be sick because I acted in foolishness. So we have our part to play. We need to be wise in the way we do things. But still, if you make a mistake, just go to God and say, Lord, I am sorry. I made a mistake. Now please heal me. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Heal me in the name of Jesus. You saw the milk has expired after 1 week. and you drank it. I mean, if you come to me, I would even say, no, go and come back after 1 week. Amen. So we have our part to play. In the same way, for emotional, mental healing, we must understand that the same way germs do bad things to our body, hatred, bitterness, anger, they do things to our spirit, our emotions, and our mind. They are germs in our mind. And it will cause sickness. In my experience casting out demons, I've realized that one of the most aggressive ones are the spirit of anger. One of the most is the spirit of anger. Very, very aggressive. It causes so many things. I cannot even begin to list them. Usually, I've noticed that it's usually the spirit of anger and bitterness. Very aggressive. We had a session, praying over people and casting out demons and those wonderful things. And this very skinny lady, when, in Jesus' name, come out, she just, skinny lady, she carried a big pastor, carried him out. I said, oh, come on now, in Jesus' name. And she said, the pastor was like, Very skinny. So anger and bitterness, they are very dangerous things. If you know what's good for you, don't allow it at all. You see, people can offend you from today to tomorrow. You forgive. I forgive you. brother, I forgive you. Even though you don't ask for forgiveness, I give you for free. I forgive. I give you for free. Because you know it is dangerous. Hallelujah. Glory to God.
My name is Emmanuel, and I'm sure you enjoyed the message that you heard. Last month was our month of love, and that was the month of October. We learned so many things about love, but what is God saying for this month of November? This is our month of healing, and we're trusting God that in this month of November, we'll be healed from every emotional trauma, we'll be healed from any mental issues, healed from any physical ailments, diseases, sicknesses, whatever they might be, even spiritual. And I'm encouraging you to join us in this journey in the month of November. And I am trusting God that He will perfect the healing that He has begun in your life. But if you heard the message and you were really, really touched today, I have a question for you. Are you born again? Because if you're not born again, you are not entitled to many of the things that we talked about. But today can be that day that you give your life to Jesus. Just a simple prayer from the depth of your heart, and I know that Jesus would accept you. So if you want to give your life to Christ today, just say this prayer after me. Dear Lord Jesus, I ask that you please forgive me of every sin that I've committed. I accept you into my heart today. I accept that I'm born again. I accept that you are Lord of my life. And I'm making you my Savior today. In Jesus' mighty name I've prayed. If you pray that prayer from the depth of your heart, according to scriptures, you are now born again. So please, I encourage you to go on our website and you find the contact us page. Send us a note. We can respond to you and possibly even send you some materials that can bless you. Thank you so much for tuning in today. And remember that Jesus loves you and Jesus is Lord. Amen.